Welcome, and see if things move as fast as they did last month. It was a grim programme in September, but a hugely successful one. Six arrests, four as a direct result of our appeals, new clues came in on other cases, and there were eight notable convictions too.
Last week, at the end of Operation Lynx, one of the biggest police operations ever mounted in the United Kingdom, Clive Barwell was given eight life sentences for a 13-year campaign of kidnap and rape. Our reconstruction created a huge response, including two viewers who rang to say they'd been assaulted by him too. Assistant Chief Constable Lloyd Clark fears there may be many other victims who've yet to come forward. But he's unstinting in his praise of Crimewatch viewers, who he says gave him a wealth of background information which helped the prosecution. You may remember these scenes from Crimewatch back in June last year. It was a raid in Godstone, Surrey. On the night of the programme, a name was phoned to Crime Stoppers, and that led to a new appeal on Crimewatch in July. This time, the informant gave two names, and as a direct result, John Terence Corley was arrested. Incriminating evidence, including large bundles of cash, was found in his house. Later, this man, Steve Buttery, was also arrested, and the two have now been sentenced for conspiracy to a total of 16 years.
More results later, but let's begin tonight's appeals with an extraordinary piece of police video.
This is the sort of crime I've investigated often, but never with such vivid images. What we're about to see is the harassment of an old man in Portsmouth who's clearly unwell. In fact, he suffers from Alzheimer's. The man who's demanding money keeps coming back for more. But this time, a hidden police camera and a microphone were ready for him.
You left a salt summit here for me today.
I have money.
Of course you have, mate. Don't be so silly.
I haven't got any money. I get plenty of what now?
I'm going to get your pension.
Eventually, he got away with £300. If you recognise him, ring us now. Studio number 0500 600 600 or 01705 891 990. That's Portsmouth 891 990.
2 months ago, three men on a tube train in West London picked on another passenger, and in front of witnesses, one of them stabbed him. It was a vicious, unprovoked knife attack. In fact, the knife was plunged into his back so hard that it snapped off. Now, these three may well be involved. This is at Acton Town, just before the stabbing. The skinhead on the right has a moschino shirt, and one in the centre, a yellow shirt, has a long brown hair tied in a ponytail. But it's the man on the left who witnesses say looks just like the knife man. He's 18 to 22 with short dark hair, and that could be a Ben Sherman shirt underneath that jacket. Please call us here on the studio, or you can ring the local police on 0171 387 0354. That's 0171 387 0354.
Tonight's first reconstruction almost speaks for itself. Three not very clever young men who seem to have no ability to understand the harm they do to other people. It happened on a Thursday lunchtime a month ago in Wolverhampton at the Kwik Save store in Heathtown.
I was in the office with Rachel, who's the assistant checkout supervisor, and we were just talking. It was a normal day, everything was fine.
Where's the manager? Where's customer services? Where's the manager?
In the store.
I saw the security guard Wayne with two blokes, and I thought, well, we're just two customers who needed to go to the toilet.
Give us the keys! Then give us the keys!
You have to get somebody else to give you the key. I haven't got the key!
Kick the door in!
Don't leave it, Rob. Leave it.
Open it! Open it! Get
Give them what they want. Just give it them.
Stay where you are. Open the till.
I can't.
Open the till!
It won't open. It needs a key.
I haven't got any keys.
Open the till! Give me the keys.
They haven't got...
Give me the keys for the till.
Have you got one? I can't open the tills. I haven't got a key.
Open the till!
Take it easy. I'll get the keys.
Shall I?
No, I'll go.
Hurry up then. Come on!
I'm doing it.
Come on, open it! Get out of the way. Where's the money? Where's the notes?
But we've had a pickup this morning!
Give me the keys! Give me the till keys!
Just stay where you are!
He was late teens or early 20s, with fairly dark black skin and a local accent.
Open all of them!
It won't open.
Do you know a white hatchback with a missing bumper? The plates are false and maybe the robbers owned the car. And were you in the Kwik Save car park? If so, please call. The hatchback turned right into Dean's Road. A few minutes later, they may have swapped cars.
Armed robbery at Kwik Save, head down. Observations for three, I see three offenders, believed to have left scene in silver or white, four-door saloon. Last seen, Dean's Road, Swordswood and All Road, over.
A silver Mondeo was seen heading towards Darlaston, with three men fitting the description of the robbers. As the patrol car got closer, the officers saw three males, all black, one tall with a shaved head, one wore small beads in his dreadlocks, and one seemed stocky. The police thought the Mondeo had gone to the garage, but actually they'd slipped down a track which leads out to Darlaston Road in Wensbury. Did you see them? And have you heard on the grapevine who they are?
Anything you've heard or seen, please let us know. The studio number is on your screen now, 0500 600 600, or you can call the incident room direct on 0902 649 163. That's Wolverhampton 649 163. Let's stop them trying this again. On this, as on any other case, you could always call Crime Stoppers too, anonymously if you want, and that's another free phone number, 0800 555 111.
Four 400 viewers rang after a hammer attack and rape on a schoolgirl in Doncaster. She'd been walking home when a man on a bike confronted her. Some very strong leads emerged from the programme, and as a result, detectives now think they know the rapist's identity. And two cases where viewers have helped to sharply focus the inquiries. A man has been charged with the murder of Laura Donnelly, attacked as she walked home from a nightclub in Paisley. The arrest was independent of Crimewatch, but 60 callers helped trace three important witnesses, a couple arguing near the murder scene and a man walking out of the Royal Alexandra Hospital car park. No arrests yet in the armed raid on a supermarket in Staffordshire, but two key suspects seen on security video came forward and have been eliminated. Coincidentally, information has helped inquiries into other crimes in the area.
Now, watch the doorway of this office in Lincolnshire. Two young men have broken in and seem to be conscious that they're on camera, but then, inexplicably, forget about the video altogether. They were both pretty incompetent and fled empty-handed, but who are they? Call the local police on 01522 882222. That's Lincoln 882222.
There's a nasty spate of robberies at estate agents in the northeast of England. Sunderland, Hebburn and Middlesbrough have all been targeted. The gunman is in his 30s with an olive or swarthy complexion. Here he is coming towards the security camera. 2 months earlier, and this time he's wearing a distinctive bomber jacket with a blue flash on his back. This raid, like most of them, are all midweek, generally on Wednesdays. And here he is again. Could this be your brother, son or friend? Help us find him. If you can, there's a £10,000 reward. Ring us here in the studio, 0500 600 600, or the local incident room on 0191 563 5100. That's Newcastle 563 5100.
This is a video store in Norwich earlier this year, and this man has a knife. He brandished it at the shop assistant and robbed the till. Now he's in his late 20s or early 30s, medium height and build, with a thin, gaunt face and dark brown hair brushed forward where he's been going bald. Who and where's he from? Studio number 0500 600 600, or you can ring the local police on 01603 768 769. That's Norwich 768 769.
The murder of Stephen Lawrence has caused an earthquake for the Metropolitan Police. Because of the failings in that inquiry, police are now very sensitive about other deaths which could have been the result of a racist assault. But one case remains stubbornly hard to resolve. No one knows if it was an accident or not. 2 years ago, Rikki Reel went out drinking with friends in Kingston, Surrey. He was later found drowned in the River Thames. We know there was an altercation between Ricky's friends and two white youths, maybe these two, just before Rikki walked off on his own. But how then did Rikki end up in the river? DCI Sue Hill is now heading the investigation. Sue, you want to trace these two guys. Very hazy image taken from a town video. 2 years later on, even they themselves are unlikely to recognise themselves or remember the events.
Well, our appeal tonight, Nick, is if anybody does recognise these individuals, or certainly if these two individuals recognise themselves, they may have been a witness to that racial incident that happened. In fact, our appeal is for anybody that was in the Kingston area that night to come forward and talk to us if they witnessed that incident.
It was a Saturday night almost exactly a year ago in Kingston Town, a Tuesday night in Kingston Town Centre almost exactly a year ago. I mean, the trouble with this, the altercation didn't even seem to be big enough for anybody to call the police or anything like that. I mean, how do you know that Rikki, his friends say he'd had quite a lot to drink, didn't just sort of walk off and fall into the river?
Well, Nick, it was 2 years ago, obviously, and we know that Rikki had a good time that night. He was a young man, good night out, and we know that after this racial incident, or during it, that Rikki had wandered off and wasn't involved in that. And where our appeal is, was anybody in the Kingston area who saw Rikki? We're trying to trace his movements from the time that he walked away from that racial incident and what happened, and he subsequently drowned.
If you can help, please do. The number is up on screen, 0500 600 600, or you can call Sue Hill's colleagues. They're standing by in the incident room on 0171 230 4374. That's 0171 230 4374.
Last July, we showed how a bank manager's terrified fiancée was snatched from a home by masked men, wrapped in a carpet and held to ransom. Several Crimewatch viewers realised they had vital information, and as a direct result, two men were arrested. One was acquitted after two trials. The other, a 21-year-old former trainee accountant, was sentenced last week to 8 years for blackmail and kidnap. And in May, we appealed for help to catch a man responsible for raping a woman in Haverhill in Suffolk. As a direct result, a 27-year-old man from St Ives has now been charged with the offence and is awaiting trial.
Our next reconstruction is quite shocking. A crime in a family house in Sutton in Surrey, southwest of London. It happened on Friday, the 2nd of July.
Morning. Why do you always get up so late? You're letting the summer pass you by.
Well, this is early for me.
My relationship with my grandfather was more than a typical grandfather-grandson relationship. Because I was the first grandson in the family, he loved me very, very much. My first initial thought was that maybe some heavy object has fallen down or something like that.
Sanjay! Shahid! They've hit me! They've hit me! Go! Call the police!
Thank you.
Sutton. Two men are trying to...
I just heard the second shot and that made me panic over the phone. I just wanted to put down the phone and run downstairs, but I was still believing that nothing has happened, everything's gonna be fine at the end.
These are killers. The second shot hit Mohammed Raja in the head. The gunman is average height, slim and in his 30s, and had a day's growth of beard. His accomplice is 6'1", in his late 20s. The moustache might not be real.
I was totally devastated. I did not know what had happened, what had struck us. It was like the end of the world for me. I would not like any other family or any other person in the whole world to go through what we've been through.
About 20 minutes later, half a mile away.
Oi! What do you think you're doing?
Did you hear the bang or see the two men run off? Anything you notice might be critical. The vehicle was bought in northeast London 3 weeks earlier. The buyer may be innocent. We badly need to find him. He's described as early 20s, stocky, 5'10", unshaven, and with short black hair.
All right, and take it easy.
Great. Yeah. Thanks for
having me. Note the Arsenal sticker, the yellow hubcaps. There were green stripes on the side, and until the murder, Thunderbird 2 on the front sign. Where was this van parked for most of June, until the day before the murder?
On Thursday morning, I saw a white van on Mulgrave Road, and the van was quite distinctive. On Friday, I was jogging as usual, and I noticed the van again. I stopped to cross over, and they actually stopped to let me cross the road. I felt a little apprehensive at the time, but the driver was staring at me.
She describes him as late 20s, Asian or mixed race, with black, wavy and untidy hair. He had two accomplices. This time the van was being driven, rather badly, by a man of similar appearance. This is a different E-fit, but it's largely the same description as that given by the jogger 4 hours earlier.
On a motive, have you got one? Mohammed Raja was a landlord. Did he have disgruntled tenants? Why did this happen?
Well, this is quite possible he did. He also was a property developer. One of the important things of the appeal tonight is to ask for anybody that knew Mohammed Raja in his business dealings or as a tenant to please contact us here this evening or at the incident room. But moreover, we're very anxious. We believe that the perpetrators of this dreadful crime clearly planned it, and we would therefore ask that if they have spoken to anybody, which I'm sure that they have, anybody involved in the planning, please contact us here tonight or the incident room. You know, nobody deserves in this world to be killed in the way that Mohammed Raja was murdered at his own front doorstep in the presence of his own family.
So you want anybody, first of all, who knew Mohammed Raja at all, at any time?
Yes, at any time.
You really want to find out as much about his background as you can, even if people who think they know nothing about it?
Absolutely. I'm convinced that they will be able to offer some contribution towards the investigation.
And you're pretty clear that there are some people who do know something about this. Whoever did this will have blabbed or word would have got out.
I think the way it's been planned, that clearly these people who have been involved, without doubt, had mentioned it to someone else. And it's those people that I would ask to come in touch, get in touch with us here this evening.
Now, why, if these people had planned it so carefully, did they then use a van that was so distinctive? I mean, people must have seen this vehicle.
Well, I think this is probably part of their plan. I accept that the vehicle, which is so distinctive, it was purchased on the 11th of June. There were some 21 days where it's been unaccounted for until the time of the murder. It is so distinctive, and somebody must have seen it, either parked outside of their house, or perhaps on a motorway, or even in a petrol station. Somebody must have seen that van, and I would appeal to anyone, no matter how insignificant they think the sighting may have been, please contact us here tonight
So anybody who knew Mohammad Raja,
yes,
anybody who has heard anything on the grapevine about this, anybody who's seen that van?
Very much so. If there's been any overhearing of conversations or anyone who's got any information about the people responsible for this crime, I urge them to contact us here tonight.
All right, Chris, thank you. If there's anything then that you can add, here's the number, 0500 600 600. Or you can ring the incident room, of course. That's 01818 531 212. Easy number to remember, 01818 531 212.
You may remember the riots in the City of London early this summer. For several hours, hooligans launched vicious attacks on buildings and the police who were protecting them. See if you know who these eight are. Out of the 6,000 demonstrators that day, fewer than 300 were violent, but it's very important they're brought to justice. Please call the incident room 0171 601 2222. That's 0171 601 2222.
Now a man to watch out for wherever you live, above all if he's lodging with you or your family. This is Christopher Pepper and he's wanted for serious sex offences against children and adults. He's originally from Birmingham but he skipped a court appearance 3 years ago and in fact could be anywhere tonight. Do please keep a lookout for him and if you've the slightest suspicions, do give us a ring. The local police are on 0121 626 1727. That's Birmingham 626 1727.
This is Raymond Price, and he's shown here coming out of Worthing Station in Sussex on a Saturday in July. That weekend, an 87-year-old resident of Worthing was murdered. Jean Barnes was bludgeoned to death in her house. There's now a reward to find her killer. Raymond Price may have nothing to do with it, but we need to find him to make sure. If you see him, don't lend him money. He spins a story saying his car has broken down and he needs to get back to Rye. It's a contract that makes him lots of money. He moves on very quickly, so call us now, 0500 600 600 or 0845 60 70 999. That's the incident room number, 0845 60 70 999.
And incidentally, if you've been a victim and you'd like to talk to someone tonight, then you can call Victim Support Line. There are people there at least until 2 o'clock in the morning. The number's 0845 30 30 900. That's a local call number, local call rate, 0845 30 30 900. There's so many calls coming in, I'm just wondering where to start. On the London Underground stabbing, we've got two names and one of them with an address, which the police think are very interesting. On the Wolverhampton armed robbery, that's on the supermarket store there, some really interesting information from a police officer who saw a very similar vehicle to the getaway one, and lots of other people have called in about that vehicle too, and we've got some names on that. Also on the Northeast estate agents and on that office burglary. I'll tell you a great deal more about that later because there is a great deal more to say, but now more on what's happened since the September programme.
A week after last month's Crime Watch, acting on information from viewers, a man was arrested for armed robbery at a building society in Ashby de la Zouche. He's been charged with robbery and possession of an imitation firearm. And the motorbike thief who went for test drives and sped off on the machines. Well, three other victims called in. Then there was a tip-off. Police went to a village in County Durham and found a garage packed with stolen bikes, with more hidden behind a false wall. Two men have been charged with conspiracy to steal. William Woodman was wanted after his girlfriend was stabbed, and several calls led police to Cambridgeshire, where he'd been working as an apple picker, but he'd just moved on. So where is he tonight?
Now a hijack, in fact two highway robberies that both took place in August. It might be the same gang, and indeed we've used the same actor as the gunman in both the reconstructions. But whether or not they're linked, they're both very serious offences involving not just armed robbery, but kidnapping and false imprisonment. The first one started in Cambridgeshire on the A1 near St Neots.
Sorry, it's going a bit quick.
Do as I say and you won't get hurt. Drive. What you carrying?
9 bars of silver.
What about the gold?
There's some gold and some scrap bits in a bucket.
How much?
I don't know, there's a ticket in the back.
Does this thing go any faster?
Yeah.
Then put your foot down.
They came straight off the A1, headed back into St Neot's, and then rejoined the A1, this time heading north. 15 miles further, the Sawtrey exit. We need to trace the discovery. Were the hazard lights on by mistake, or was this a signal to the White Transit? Five minutes later, and they turned into the farm track leading to the end of the runway at Peterborough Business Airfield. Was it a coincidence that this is very close to where the van is based?
Put your head in the steering wheel, look down and stay there!
The van was carrying reclaimed silver ingots and a small amount of gold. How did the gang know about the cargo? And what's their connection with Ramsey, where the van was based, and where they plundered it? From Friday the 6th of August in Cambridgeshire to Saturday the 21st at Heathrow.
Hi Colin, how are you?
Okay, got 16 of these.
You going to help me load up?
I picked up 16 pallets. Whatever is on them pallets, that's nothing to do with me.
Well, Bax Global have the customs papers for me?
Yeah, there's somebody over there who'll give you a lift with it.
It could have been computer components, it could have been computers, but on according to my papers and the loading collection sheet what I had, it didn't say. I set off about 20 past 11 that Saturday morning from Heathrow.
His route took him round the M25 to the M40 and up past Birmingham onto the M6.
Driving itself, it's getting harder and frustrating by the day. Traffic jams, congestions. So, I mean, if you have a Saturday like this, Sunday, and just heading straight for home, no traffic jams, is one of the nicest things which actually can happen to you. I've been in a situation before, unmarked police car. It's nothing different.
Traffic inspectorate, can I see your tacos, please?
He was about 40, stocky, average height, with a shaved head and a London accent.
Can I have your tacos for last week and today, please?
Sure.
He was no pushy or anything, you know, quite just normal. For me, they acted as proper policemen.
It's okay.
I could put a bullet in you right now. You cooperate and nothing will happen. Give me the keys to the lorry.
Get in.
Who's got the keys?
Give him the keys to Russell!
For me, it was the guy who knew about lorries because no gear crunching or anything, it just pulled off, you know.
I'm gonna stop and put him in the boot.
No, I'll do it.
Get out of the car!
There was constant radio one on. I couldn't hear actually if there was conversation. The only thing I had was my watch. So I tried to time them as much as I could. For the next 2 hours, they must have just driven more or less motorway. It's about 10 to 7. I felt 2 to 3 humps. And the car drove slowly over it, stopped and reversed somewhere. That is when I really got frightened, when it got dark and it just sped off, you know. Then it was really a high speed.
An hour later, this is at Gaydon, off junction 12 of the M40.
Get out! Phone box that way! Hijacked. My lorry has been hijacked. I need to call the police.
There's a phone in the pub, is that?
We need this witness in the black Calibra to call in. At about the same time, the lorry was discovered parked at the welcome break services at junction 8A on the M40 near Oxford, and it had only just been left there.
Felt on, this is what they stole. A large number of these compact laptop computers. There's just one snag. No keyboards?
That's correct, Nick. There's 1,440 laptop computers, compact make, three different types. As you can see, they've got no keyboards in them. I'd appeal to anyone who's been offered a laptop without a keyboard, or a technician or supplier who's been asked to if they can get hold of one.
Where would they source these things?
Well, the actual point of origin is outside the UK, but it might well be that they're making inquiries to try and find out where they are. The actual quantity, as I've said, is over 1,400, and there's 288 boxes.
And they're quite big large boxes. I've got one of them here. So how many of these?
280.
Jolly heavy, I can tell you. That's 280 right. Boxes.
288,
like this.
And that's a total weight of 5.5 tons. And I'd just like to say that, you know, they need an area of considerable size to store these goods, and similarly to unload it. And I'd also like to appeal to people to think where they were between about 10 to 7 and 20 past 8 on Saturday the 21st. Did they see that wagon, which is quite distinctive, or a Laguna parked up and a man acting suspiciously?
What sort of area do you think it might have been?
We think it went to the western area of London. So we'd be looking to anyone who has access to a unit in that area who looks like the descriptions of the offenders.
And they're going to have fun. It's jolly difficult to get rid of these, because I know you've stopped all the legitimate supplies, bulk supplies of keyboards.
That's correct.
To these things. One slip-up, or was it a slip-up, maybe a double blind, that name Russell that one of them used during the hijack?
Yeah. The victim, the HGV driver, remembered three important things. First of all, he remembered the name Russell being used. We don't know whether that was a slip of the tongue or whether, with the adrenaline of having just committed the offence, they've actually used the right name. He also was able to spot a number on the underside of the parcel shelf. This was a six-digit number, 020292.
2nd of February 1992.
We unfortunately not. We thought that at first. It's a manufacturer's number which has come from France. So I'd appeal to anybody who's had the Laguna stolen, a dark blue Laguna, can they check around that time if they had it stolen or if they loaned it to anyone, or if the company hired a vehicle out of that type, or if somebody's got a hire car now, can they go and have a look? If they've got that number, can they give us a ring?
Underneath the parcel shelf at the back?
As you lift the boot, the number is on the underside of the
020292.
That's right.
One of the drivers is very badly traumatised. I mean, this may look like a piece of you know, dramatic, quite exciting sort of hold-up. Actually, it's terrifying for the guy's concerned.
It was absolutely terrifying for him. He's still off work. He's undergone stress counselling. But he did also remember the fact that he was stopped by a Calibra. I'd also appeal to that man to come forward. He may well have seen the offenders leaving the scene. It was very quickly after it happened.
Okay. I suspect several people watching will have an idea who these gang members are as it happens. And there is a reward, quite a big reward, about £20,000, and it could well go higher. There's a free call here to the studio, of course, or you can call to Phil Charlton's colleagues at the Cheshire Incident Room on 012 44 614 234. That's Chester, 614 234. Another number is the Cambridgeshire incident room on 01 480 422 666. That's Huntingdon 422 666.
A year ago, we appealed for help after the death of John Nutter, an elderly man who died during a violent robbery on his home. 3 weeks ago, as a direct result of our appeal, two men already known to the police were sentenced to 10 years each for manslaughter. Now another appeal on a crime we reconstructed last November. Linda Bryant was out walking her dog near St. Maur's in Cornwall when someone waylaid and attacked her. She died from stab wounds. Two Crimewatch viewers rang the police with what they thought was very minor information, but it seems to be the best clue yet. The day before the murder, they saw a white van in the area, and no one locally knows whose it is. So were you in Rouen High Lanes on a Monday in October, almost exactly a year ago today? Think back and please ring in.
Chris Borland, what sort of a van was it? How much do you know about this van?
Well, this important sighting, Nick, was just one of about five that were seen in the days leading up to the murder and on the day of the murder. We believe that it's either an Austin Maestro or a Ford Escort or a Bedford van, possibly like the old post office vans, and your witnesses from Crimewatch described that sort of vehicle. Now, we will have contact in the region of 8,000 registered owners across Devon and Cornwall, and to date we've not yet come across them. So does this person come from outside Devon and Cornwall, and hence the appeal tonight?
When you say this person, do you have a description of the person? Do you have a description of the driver? Do you know anything about it?
We can't say for definite that these sightings are all the same, but there is a consistency in the description of the driver, and that is somebody who's aged between 40 and 50 years of age, and most importantly, has got an unkempt, straggly, brown beard that is streaked with grey, and that has been consistent throughout.
Now, obviously, this is the killer, or it's somebody who needs to be eliminated. If it's somebody who had nothing to do with Linda Bryant and is sort of really worried about coming in at this stage of the inquiry, when things seem to point to them, what would you say to him? How easy is it to eliminate somebody?
Well, we've done a very meticulous and painstaking inquiry over the last 12 months, and we have assimilated a lot of evidence. I have no difficulty in saying that if you are not involved, and even after this amount of time and the amount of publicity we've given to this white van, if you're not involved, you have nothing to worry about. But I do believe equally that this person could be the person we're looking for.
Now, if it is, and somebody's got an idea of somebody who looks a bit like that, maybe had access to a white van, what other clues, personality, have you got anything else at all? I mean, I know you've had an offender profile, and I don't know how much of that you can tell
us.
Yes,
we have, and the sightings of these white vans prior to the murder fit in with that profile, which suggests that this is a planned murder. I don't believe it was about Linda Bryant. This is somebody who was looking for somebody in an isolated location. Now, it's difficult to put a definitive on this, but I think that probably we're looking for somebody who's a loner, who is perhaps not in a stable relationship, and certainly won't like women, has a hatred of women. But more importantly, and this is what I would say, it's how important it is for people to ring in, is that I truly believe that if we don't catch this man, then there is every possibility that he will strike again. So however small that information or insignificant people think it is, let us decide and ring in.
All right, Chris, thank you. Well, even if it's a long shot, you've heard how serious this is, give us a call. Here are the numbers. Let's either eliminate this van or find the killer. 0500 600 600, that'll bring you straight here to the studio. Or you can call the incident room on 01 392 452 470. That's Exeter, 452 470.
In mid-July, Daniel Collins left a note saying he'd murdered his girlfriend, and back at his flat, we found the body of Bejra Elevica. Alarmingly, this is the second woman known to Collins who's died in violent circumstances. Here he is at a petrol station in West London. He suffers from depression, and we know he had a road smash in Ascot, Berkshire. So has he come to you for medical attention? He's also liked to be sleeping rough and maybe stealing food. You might have noticed an eagle tattooed on his forearm or the letters LO on his fingers. If you've seen Daniel Collins, and you may know him under the name Jones or Hurley, then please give us a ring on 0181 247 8265. That's 0181 247 8265.
And this is George Bernard Murray Houlihan. There's a warrant out for his arrest on two charges of raping teenage girls. He has a strong Glaswegian accent and is relatively short at 5'6". Now, he could have been in West London with a large number of £50 notes in the last couple of months, but where is he tonight? Call the incident room direct on 01661 863 000. That's Pontyland 863 000.
Imagine you're at work on a routine day and suddenly two men burst in pointing guns at you. These are out-and-out thugs at a petrol station in Croydon, Surrey, about a year ago. They're both white in their mid-20s with beer guts. Have they been bragging about the robbery down the pub? Please just tip us off and we'll do the rest. 0171 407 6319. That's 0171 407 6319. And on all these cases, you can ring us here on the studio on 0500 600 600.
Huge number of people already rung. Just trying to go through some of the calls we've had on Rikki Reel, incidentally. We've got one man who thinks that he was one of the people who was in that video, that CCTV video from 2 years ago. On the supermarket raid in Wolverhampton, yet another name which seems to fit in with something we heard earlier. The Mohammed Raja murder, two prison officers, one of the former prison officer, have given a name that they recognise as someone from the EFITs, they think. On the London riots, we've got four names put forward on that. On Raymond Price, we may have an address as well as a name on that, and quite a number of other things on that which the police are looking into at the moment, and I therefore can't tell you much more about. There really is a lot of stuff that's coming in now, and of course we'll give you a great deal more in the update programme. A quick reminder of some of the faces that we've shown you tonight. Christopher Pepper, who's wanted for serious sex offences. Raymond Price, wanted for questioning on the murder of Jean Barnes. Daniel Collins, wanted in connection with the murder of his girlfriend. And there's a warrant out for the arrest of George Houlihan on two charges of raping teenage girls. If you do know where any of these people are tonight, if you've seen them recently, please ring us here in the studio. It's live. The phones are on now and will be till midnight, 0500 600 600. As I say, we'll be taking calls for almost 2 hours now. And other numbers are on CFAX page 621. Or you can email us at crimewatchuk@thebbc. Crimewatch update is at 11:20. Please come back then and see how things are getting on. But if it's bedtime before then, rest assured we really are on the way to cracking several of these crimes. So don't have nightmares. Do sleep well. Good night.